Okay, good morning. Just a quick announcement about today's office hour. I would not go straight to my office as I do usually after this class. I'll be home by 12:15, and I'll be available on Zoom between 12 or 12:15 until 1:15. Okay, so the Zoom link can be found in the syllabus or in my emails, in the email signature, or you can email me and I'll send you the link. I'll probably be doing the same on Monday. I want to remind you that from Monday until May 13th, you can deliver your presentation on Zoom in front of me by scheduling it, by selecting a time slot with the help of the Calendly.com app. And you find the link here, Calendly.com/AndreaFed, it's also easy to remember. You find it also inside the syllabus. Today, at the end of this class, if there is time, I'm going to ask you if you have any questions about the oral presentation, any questions about your final project. If I don't have enough time for that today, I'll do it on Friday, okay? And again, next week, I'll try to reserve some time for any kind of general questions about the presentation and the project. Of course, if you want specific support, if you want to discuss your specific project or technical details, technical aspects of your project, come to my office hours on Zoom or schedule an appointment. Other than being in meeting or from next week having your presentations on Zoom, I'll be available most afternoons. And you can schedule a meeting the same day. You can write to me in the morning to schedule a meeting in the afternoon or during the afternoon and have a meeting with me a few minutes or an hour later. So what I'm going to do today, as promised, is to offer an overview of some interesting apps that were not included in the focus segments of this semester. We focused on, for this particular semester, on Notion, Evernote, and DocuWiki. Today, I'll be talking about Obsidian, which is one of the most interesting new apps for knowledge management, as well as Workflowy, which is mostly an outliner, but an app that was created in 2010 and has evolved in interesting ways. And if there is time, I'll show you briefly Nimbus Notes, which is an alternative to Evernote, but also in many ways a clone of Evernote that was born out of the amount of discontent manifested by users, traditional users of Evernote, when the app Evernote transitioned from its traditional format to what is now called the new Evernote. Obsidian is quite recent, however, in many ways, Obsidian is the descendant of DocuWiki and similar wikis. The popularity of DocuWiki is declining, even among those who use similar wiki software, because one thing we didn't observe when we talked about DocuWiki is that DocuWiki is a successful representative of a family. At some point, there was a website called Wikimatrix that listed all open source wiki software, and that list at some point was almost 100 titles long, and DocuWiki was simply one of the top 3 or top 10, depending on the season, in terms of the number of download. DocuWiki is the direct expression of the basic philosophy of a wiki devised by Cunningham, the man we mentioned, even in reference to Wikipedia and whether Wikipedia is more of a wiki, more of an encyclopedia. What is that makes Obsidian very similar to DocuWiki? Well, for one thing, it is free. The free version includes most of the functions, even the advanced functions. And the reason why it is free is that the basic version would be like having DocuWiki on your computer. That is to say, the free version of Obsidian calls for the files, the text files, that where the code is stored. They're all MD files, so text file with a markdown extension. From that point of view, they're future-proof, because Markdown is kind of a universal language of the internet. Any text file with Markdown can be converted in any number of ways. It's not some kind of proprietary code or format. But as I was saying, in the free version of Obsidian, all the text files that represent the notes and that include the tags and the links that make this into an agile kind of knowledge repository are saved on your computer. Of course, if you want to, you can opt to store the vault where all the files of Obsidian are on OneDrive, Google Drive, on Dropbox, on any kind of platform on the cloud, and you'll be responsible for fees if you have a paid subscription to those services. But basically, both in the case of DocuWiki and Obsidian, you have a free software, you can simply download it for multiple OSs. You find the Windows version, you find even the Windows ARM version for the Surface Pro X and X2 by Microsoft, for example. You find the macOS, the iOS version, the Android version, the Linux version. The basic version is free, and what you pay for, if you want a paid plan, is either to sync your files, your notes, across multiple devices. Although if you store these files on the cloud, there are workarounds that allow you to share the notes across devices yourself if you are willing to tinker a little bit. So you pay to sync the files across multiple devices, or you pay to publish those files, which implies that, of course, server time is being used. And if you store anything on the servers of the company, it's only fair that you would be paying for that. The other thing that makes it very similar to DocuWiki is that the code is very similar, and it's based on this system, on variations of the basic Markdown system, right? For example, hashtag for titles, or stars, double stars for bold, single stars for italics, and double underscores or single underscores for the same results, etc. So everything happens very quickly because you just use your keyboard, and the coding itself is not difficult to learn. In about an hour, you can become fluent with that. Similarly to what happens with DocuWiki, the power of the system is all based on the intellectual work that you put in it. Meaning that this becomes a powerful knowledge management system as much as you want if you add tags and links, if you create connections inside the system. What Obsidian will offer, as we will see in just a bit, compared to DocuWiki, what more it offers is the possibility of visualizing the relationships between nodes with the help of graphs or maps. It's the same thing. You can call them, they call them graphs. The community of users on YouTube often calls them maps of content, or MOC. You can, even in this case, embed files, right? So you can embed an audio file, a video file, a PDF inside an Obsidian node. Of course, keep in mind that in the free version, those files need to be local, right? Because all the nodes are local. So you can embed an image using the link, but if you want to embed a YouTube video, it will not work unless you have a plugin. You will have to, you can only embed a video that is stored on your computer. In both cases, you have a community that has developed a number of plugins, and the plugins will allow you, for example, to insert a table of content, which is not by default a feature of the program, or do other things, more imaginative things. Both Obsidian and DocuWiki offers you the option of looking at bank links. That is to say, you can not only move from one node to another, but you can see also the nodes that link to any particular node. So I'm going to open the program, show you a few features, and then we'll move on to the next app. Feel free to interrupt if you have any questions or any comments. This is the website of the app. The address is obsidian.md. Let me adjust the lights. And the dark mode is one of the features of Obsidian, although once you open the app, you can choose between a white background or a black background, but that is the most common opted for feature of Obsidian. As you can see, there is a pricing system, but the personal plan is $0 forever. And in fact, you don't need much because everything is local, both the software and the nodes. Right? So even if they go out of business, you can still continue to operate the program as long as it remains compatible with the OS where you installed it. And you have a few paid plans. What they're not showing you here is simply the option of paying, I think it's $10 per month or so, $9 or $10 per month to share the, maybe it's here. Yeah, there it is. Additional services, so you can sync the notes automatically across different devices or publish those notes on the internet. Of course, they have help files. The help files themselves are created with the language of the app, right? And here as well, you see right away the interface, the typical interface of Obsidian, where you have different sections, but these are, can actually be nodes in your app. Whatever you're looking at, whatever you select from here, right, a section or a node, and in here you see the graph. And the graph is showing you how what you're looking at now, format your nodes, is connected to other nodes, to other materials. And of course, you can simply move things around, click, select. You can introduce tags into the graphs. You can make that visualization more powerful. And I'll just show you the examples I created on the app. As I said, this is the 64-bit ARM version of the app because my Microsoft Surface Pro X tablet runs the ARM version of Windows. So at the beginning, when you when you install the app, you decide where the repository of all the notes will be and what is its name will be. In this case, the vault, as they call it, was called Obsidian by me, and I placed it on OneDrive so that I can access it from different devices. And then inside the so-called vault, as you can see here, you can add a single note, a new note, or you can add a folder, and then within a folder, you can add notes, and you can organize your notes in any number of ways. You can also multiply the number of vaults, actually, if you want to consider the vault like an area, a project. So it's up to you to give it a structure or no structure at all and just rely on links and tags. As I said before, this is all based on Markdown, and they use a system whereby you can look at the outcome of the code, but you can also see the code whenever you click on a single block and modify it. Otherwise, you can also change it from here, right? Right now is the hybrid view, but I can change it to the editing view to see the codes permanently. In this kind of hybrid view, when I click on a block, as I did now, the title remains formatted as it is, but I can also see the code that made this a H1 level title. So if I add a second hashtag, you see that it changes the formatting. I forgot to add that one thing that makes it similar to DocuWiki is the fact that besides the code that modifies, makes a changes a title from one format to another, there is also a template that you can create or modify in the background. So for example, if you want to use another font family, if you want to change the size of a title, then you create and add some CSS code to do that, right? To personalize it, or you can borrow from the community a pre-made template that you like and you add it to your files in a specific folder, okay? So in this system, similarly to what we did with DocuWiki, you need to separate paragraphs with blank lines. Otherwise, two consecutive sub-paragraphs will be joined once you switch to reading mode. You can also opt out of that. Of course, used to the old standards of wiki software such as DocuWiki, so this is what I opted for. As I said, there are Markdown codes to produce, let me see if I can expand this, yes. To produce italics or bold, as you can see in here, right? I can see it just as it is, or I can see the code that produces that formatting, which is two stars, but I can also use two underscores, okay? And I can modify that if I want to. So let me see, for example, if I add this, if I add a third star, of course, it will become both both italicized and bolded. This block is italicized. If I click on it, I can see the code connected to it. Of course, I can also rely on the alternative of using the keyboard, because if I want to italicize this block, I select it, or this single word, and then if I press Control I, you see that the code is added automatically, and this is made italics right now, and I can see the code attached to it, but the code disappears because I don't want to my view to be cluttered by the code. So it's a bit more advanced in several ways than DocuWiki. The missing features mostly have to do with collaboration. This is a personal database, a personal knowledge management app or system where collaboration can be achieved with plugins and workarounds, and instead, collaboration features are built into DocuWiki from the start. If you want to insert code, this is you use the tilde that you find at the top left corner of your keyboard. And if you want to connect to, if you want to connect to another note, try to make it visible. Okay, let me see. Yeah, this is a little bit better. If you want to introduce a link to another note or create a new note, all you do is, as in the case of DocuWiki, add two square brackets, and then when you start typing, the system will bring up any other note that contains the words you're typing, and then you can select from there to link to an existing note, or you can continue and type the title of a note that doesn't exist. And then once you click on that note that doesn't exist, you are taken to it and you can add content to it. So very similar to DocuWiki, and it is the new DocuWiki because it's generating the kind of enthusiasm that software such as DocuWiki was producing in the early 2000s. If you go on YouTube, there isn't a lot of excitement about Notion anymore. Notion has taken the corporate way. There isn't a lot of excitement about Evernote. Not brilliant, not innovative, not creative enough. The two cutting edge apps that most people are talking about are Roam, R-O-A-M, which is more expensive and more complicated in some ways, and Obsidian, and especially the fact that Obsidian can be used even in the free version is attracting a lot of people, and that's where you find hundreds of thousands of views for the videos talking about this particular app. This is how you can, one of the many ways that you can create a link. If you want a link with a label, you use single square parentheses. Within those single individual square parentheses, you put whatever you want to appear, and then you follow that with regular parentheses, and that's where you put the link you want to. Of course, as in the case of DocuWiki, you can just also type a link or copy a link and it will become clickable right away, right? As you can see, as I type, it becomes clickable. Tags are introduced by an hashtag, and the difference between a tag and a title, both use the hash code, is that in the case of a tag, you type a letter right after the hashtag. In the case of a title, of a heading, H1, H2, H3, H4, you put a space after the hash, okay? And that makes it a title. And of course, even the same way that links to another note are clickable, even tags are clickable, and we'll show you course, I've restricted the view. There it is. We'll show you on the sidebar every note that includes that particular tag, and it starts a search whereby I can continue add words to limit my search, to restrict, to narrow my search, to limit the number of results that I see. And of course, from here, I can also click and be transferred to that particular note. So we'll click on this, be transported to this other note. And again, if I have my cursor on one particular block, then I'll see the code as well. Otherwise, I'll see the effects of the code on the formatting. This is a link to another note. This is a tag. And lists and number lists are very simple to produce. At the beginning of a line, you put a hyphen, and when you add a space, then it turns into a list where you start from a level, and then using tabs, you can go to a sub-level, and it continues on the same level. But if you press enter twice, it goes down one level. If you do it from this, then you go back to a regular block. In the case of numbered lists, you just start with a number. Could be the number one. And once you add the space, you can create this list. Same thing with the tabs. You can go to different levels. And of course, the fact that in this case I have one for the top level of the numbered list and one for the sub level could be changed by introducing a difference in the standard template by codifying it in CSS. I can make the numbered list go from 1 to A, from 1A to numeral number 1. I can make it a more complex alphanumeric list. In this case as well, if I press enter multiple times, I'm brought to different levels or to out of the list. And as I said, you can start the list from any number. As long as you have a number followed by a dot and a space, then the list will continue from there. Tasks are created as simply, since tasks are a form of list, you start with a hyphen, then you give it a space, and then two square brackets with a space in between will give you an element of the list. Okay, and of course, this is clickable, and the task is done. Let me go back in here. This is how an image is produced. Once I click on it, I can see the code. I have an exclamation point followed by the label I want to give or caption I want to give to that image, and in regular parentheses, I have the direct link to an image that I took from Wikipedia. Okay, and there it is. That's the image. And I can also modify the size of the image easily. I can show you the help files, where you can see what we did, for example, for the embeds, the use of the exclamation point, the headers, right, with different number of hashes, italics, bold, the lists, etc. Everything is easy to learn. Okay, now going back to this, one of the advantages that Obsidian has compared to DocuWiki, and one of the reasons why it has become so popular, is that you can have multiple nodes, as many as your screen will allow, placed horizontally or vertically, so that you can compare the contents, have some notes with basic material, basic information open to your right, and have the text you're working on, let's say a paper, short story, an article, a blog, at the left side, and scan the information you have in the various notes and compose paragraphs in the text you're working on. And this is achieved quite simply from these dots, where I can split vertically and have multiple notes. Of course, my screen is not that big, especially because of the resizing induced by the resolution of the projector. But imagine this in a regular screen with a better resolution. And of course, I can close any of these, right? And of course, in here you have two copies of the same note, but I can put different notes in there. And anytime I want, I can go from there to the backlinks and also the graph showing me the complex relations between the notes that I have created. And this is kind of small simply because the assumption is that you would be doing this with tens of different notes or even hundreds of different notes. And as you can see, I have different notes in here as well as tags. That, and it's kind of faint, but you have the relationship between one and the other, and you can choose to focus on one or go to a note from that visual representation. So that was Obsidian. I would recommend that you, if you're interested, that you look for videos on Obsidian on YouTube. You'll find several of them that are well made and explain the advantages of using this particular app. Meanwhile, I'll move to Workflowy. Workflowy is my daily app. Right now, during this particular period, is the app that I use more frequently, is the app that I use to write down notes and ideas, to organize the tasks for my day. And it is an outliner, meaning that you can start anywhere, right, from any level, typing, and from there, you can click on a note and develop this at different levels, right, using the tabs. But anytime you create a note, you can focus just on that particular note. Let me go back and show you something more meaningful. So this would be an example of a note. Of course, the top level should have a title. My choice is, instead of a title, to start with tags. And tags can be produced with hashtags or with ampersands. That is my option because I use the hash instead for formatting, because there is a plugin that allows you to introduce tags to modifying the font or other formats, to add colors, etc. So instead of a title, I lead with tags, because this way, within each node, I can format, I can sort all the nodes, and they will be sorted by tag. So automatically, everything that pertains to this class, CCS 395, will come together. And then if I want to, I can move, I can drag one node inside another. That is to say, instead of having at some point 100 different notes above CCS 395, I can put some of them together just by moving them. As you can see, all these tags are clickable, and whenever you click on a tag, all the nodes with that tag within an area will come up. I'll show you later, of course, in here, we have a limited amount of text, but I'll show you later. In this case as well, I can simply write, and there are two ways to format. One is to select and use the toolbar to make something bold, underlined, italics, to add a link to something or to add a highlight to something. Or I can use the keyboard, select a word, and with the keyboard type Control B or Command B for bold, Control I for italics, Control U for underlined. Now, in this case, the bulleted lists are built in, but there is no way to make them numeric lists unless you have a plugin. There is no way to make a task with the nice box. However, there is a built-in feature that allows you, if something is a task, to mark it as completed using Control Enter. And the way I've configured the app, once a task is completed, it disappears. However, you can use the check mark icon at the top of the interface to make those completed tasks reappear. Right? And if I click, you see how the completed task is back. But the completed task is still there. Even when it disappears, it is not deleted and can be part of the search. Even in this case, I can simply type a link and it becomes clickable, or I can attach a link to a word. I can link to an existing node. And again, when I start typing using the square brackets, the system will suggest notes that are similar to what I'm typing, or I can type the title of a new note and then open it and write something on it, right? So in this case, this is where I go. And of course, I have backlinks in here as well that I can unfold that tells me where the note I'm in is linked. Let me show you. Oh, of course, in here, you can have some favorites. So for example, things that I do frequently is add notes about you guys or grades for your homework assignments, etc. And therefore, this is where I go. And in here, I find the names of all the students, and each student is a different node. And within that node, you have different levels. For example, something about meetings or about assignments. Each assignment is a different node, and therefore, I can add information there. I have a personal journal. I have students to advise in the GLI major and minor, etc. But let me go back to the notes level, or I can go back to the home and then in here, and I can show you if I click on testing. Now I have all the notes in there that are marked as testing. And from there, I can add. You see how by clicking, automatically the tag entered the search area. And I can add another tag simply by clicking, right? And I'm going from 5 to 2, or I can add a simple word. Of course, in the search area, I can also use the Boolean operators. I can use or. Everything that I type there is like and, so I don't have to use and, but I can use or not, etc., right? Until I find what I'm looking for. So I can add explore, and now I have a single node among all that I was looking for. So it's pretty agile. Learning curve is almost non-existent, basically from any device, because this app is available for iOS, Android, Windows, Mac OS. And you can also use it in the browser. As you see here, I'm not using the app. I'm just opening this in the browser. From there, you can just type, you can just add links and tags and organize something. And of course, those links and tags can grow based on your needs. Whenever you do some exploring, you can add more tags or multiply the number of links to fit the kind of work that you're doing. Because it can be used also as a productivity app, you can also add dates and search by date. That date you find there is just textual, but otherwise the system allows you to add dates that can be used for the search. Going to the search box, whenever I start looking for anything, any tag, for example, in this case, I have a selection of possible options based on frequency, right? That allows me to select tags without having to memorize what my tags are. There are plugins that allow you to sort the material, do find and replace, produce a node with all the tags that you have attached to all of the nodes, etc., etc. Everything resides on the servers of Workflowy, and of course they have a limited free version, limited in terms of the amount of material, the number of nodes that you have, or a paid version that allows you to have an unlimited amount of content stored on their server. You can also have a backup sent to a cloud so that you have control over the material that you store in Workflowy. Let me conclude with Nimbus Notes, show you this Evernote clone. It came out a few years ago. Ready to go. Okay, still loading. Okay. You recognize how similar it is to Evernote and to other apps as well. In here, you can have folders and notes. In here, you have pages that would be produced by any search or all the nodes in a certain area. And then to the right, you have the node itself, and you can limit your view to just these single nodes. When you select a node and start typing, let me resize this. Whenever you select something inside the node, you have a toolbar that allows you to format something as bold, italics, underlines, strike through, code, etc., to add links, to add ink if you have a tablet, to modify the color, to have different colors, different highlights. As in the case of Evernote, you can share the notes, you can publish the notes online. And on top, you have the tags that were added. Since this is a fresh app, I had the opportunity to interact via email with the founder of Nimbus Notes, and I told him that I didn't like the fact that you cannot see the tags, all of them, when you have multiple tags, even if I have space. Why should the system tell me plus two? I want to see those tags, right? Whenever I open the note, I want to see if the tags are sufficient or I need to add more tags without having to click, especially, as I said, when the space is available. Not to mention in some cases, if the tag label is too long, it'll be abbreviated with an ellipsis. So I don't have the advantage of looking at the content and compare the tags and see if I'm doing the right thing. This was never modified. I'm not important enough, right? And if I click on plus two, I can see those notes and I can add more, right? And now if I add more, I have plus three, but I don't know what the three are, etc. In here as well, you can introduce links to external websites as well as other notes, and you have all the advanced features that you can expect. You can search by tag, by multiple tags, by combination of tags and simple words. And of course, it is as easy as with Evernote to add images, to embed videos, and they also have a web clipper, the same as you find in Evernote. So there are only slight differences between Evernote and Nimbus, but as I said, Nimbus capitalized on the negative reactions that Evernote users had to the changes that were brought by the original company. They also offered a more reliable system. One of the things that Evernote users, traditional Evernote users, were complaining, and I've experimented that myself, is that once you have a collection of Evernote notes across different devices, no two devices have exactly the same number of notes. There are some conflicts that generates the duplication of notes. If two notes are different, and modified at different times, sometimes instead of the changes converging into one version of the note will be duplicated with two different historical versions of the note, but you don't see that right away. It's something that exists in the background. And so this affects the confidence that users have in the reliability of Evernote or similar apps. Okay, that was it for my presentation. We have a little time, if you want to talk about the presentation, the project, the final exam, if you want to, although I'll be talking again about the final exam either Friday or Monday, when I'll show you the short list, the readings and material, the topics on which I will base the creation of the questions, of the essay questions in the exam. So right now it's mostly questions about the presentation and the final project. How can I assist you right now? Yes, Chase.
So for the wiki page, are you just sort of like what requirements looking for? Like say if like for one wiki page it has a bunch of pages, are you trying to look for that? Like multiple pages or multiple
links? Right, it has to be multiple pages by all means, right? Otherwise it's not a wiki. If it has only one page, and also it's not a good approach, because if you store everything in one place, then it's like a book or a chapter. It's something that I have to read from top to bottom in order to access the material. There are no dynamic ways to reorganize the material. So you create a bunch of pages. So for example, if you create your project in Notion, the best way is to start with a table. Within that table, you'll have the first column that says name, where you can create pages. Whenever you type something in that name column, that will be the title of a page that doesn't exist. Next to it, the open button will appear. You can access that, and you can create a page that will have tags. And then from the table itself, which will have different pages with any number of tags, you can demonstrate during your presentation how the material can be clustered differently, filtered in different way using tags as well as other properties of the pages. So my advice is, in general, don't make your pages too long, because the idea, and you can find plenty of YouTube videos and blogs about this, the idea is to atomize the information, to make blocks of information that focus tightly on a topic, so that whenever you need to access everything that is related to a topic, you have the minimum amount of noise, the minimum amount of extraneous material, right? Because even when you filter out content, if you have a page that is connected to 15 different tags, semantically organized because relates to all sorts of things, then what kind of advantage have you established for your user? You've brought up something that is relevant, but the user still has to scroll and scroll and scroll until they find what they're looking for exactly. Whereas if you have compact pages, something that I can glance over in one screen or two screens, I'm almost at the final destination after I perform a search with tags or keywords. So have comp pages and multiply the number of pages so that you can demonstrate how the content can be reorganized or accessed in different, more creative ways. That is one part of the power of your project. The other part is, besides the tags, the links. Links create possibilities for another kind of journey across the pages, whereby I start reading a page to which I arrived simply because I clicked on the title from a list or because I use tags to limit the number of pages that are relevant to me. And I start reading, but then I find links that take me to a journey through material, contents, blocks, even that are connected to it. So that's a wiki. A bunch of pages that house different kind of contents with relationships built through the help of tags and links.
For that, like, you don't want, it doesn't have to be just like one section with all the pages. It could be used throughout my whole page or any pages. It could be, it's talking about, so I'm going to say,
within each page, you can create sections, like, and subsections, right?
Because pages in like words, like, you know, like on Wiki, they'll say like, oh, it's for, you can do this for this company. You click this word that says this company, you bring it to the page of this company and everything.
Right. Yes, that's one way to create connections among the pages. Absolutely. And within each page, you use the design features and the stylistic features to make the content more accessible within that page. So even if you have a compact page, you still want to break it down in sections and subsections so that instead of going through the whole thing, I can look at the table of content, click, and go straight to a block that I'm interested in. You can use highlights and colored fonts to make some content stand out so that instead of scrolling and looking at the page and trying to read everything, I only look at whatever is in a certain color, whatever is highlighted, because I know that those are the keywords for each block, for each paragraph within a section, a given section with its own topic. You can use the call out depending on the tab you have, right? But absolutely, the basic answer is you have to have a multiplicity of pages. An exact number is hard to give. It is based on your choice of a content, but usually it is more than a handful of pages. Again, it's difficult to answer because you may go different ways at creating connections, because you can connect pages, but you can also connect single blocks within pages. Whenever you have an issue, you are worried about the adequacy of your project in terms of content. Do I have enough? You simply share the project with me as a draft to have that kind of feedback from me, as some people have done, or you come to a Zoom meeting, you share the screen, you show your project, you show me what you've done, and I can see and tell you, you should break down your pages or add more pages. Oftentimes, it's not the content itself, but how you distribute it across the pages. Right, you want to distribute it in such a way that you take the user almost directly to content. And some of the apps allow you, if you want to have separate blocks and to put the blocks together also in longer version of the pages using the process called transcription. Okay, that's it for today. Thank you for coming.